Okay, so after the focus that Sacha is making on research in OpenMT, which is very important because the research part is really what is making OpenMT at the state of the art. I will have another focus today, which is on the industry bridge, which is another reason why I think OpenMT had a good uptake at the very beginning, is that it was ready for industry. And we made everything possible to make that ready for industry, starting from the code from Kim Yoon at the very beginning and making a software out of that. And we are committed to that, and I will go through that point today. And I will also announce some new product, OpenMT product we are launching that will continue making the life of industry easier. So in two words, Sistran. So Sistran, we are doing machine translation and just machine translation. So we have been doing that for the last 50 years. So I have not been doing that for 50 years, but the company has been doing that for 50 years. It is the 50th year of Sistran this year. And from the very beginning, we were kind of forerunner. So there was different type of technology. There was what you call the rule-based technology that's on which we focused for years. So it was really the symbolic representation of language and a bit related to what Sacha was mentioning, but very pragmatic, putting rules in the system. Then we have a wave of the statical machine translation, a 10-year wave that was led by Google, basically, because they were the first one to be able to put that technology online on large scale. And the new wave is now, and started 2 years ago for us. So Sistran, we are 150 in three sites, San Diego, Paris, and Seoul. Paris is the R&D center of Sistran, and I am leading the global R&D. So we are, our offer is a product, so we are selling enterprise server for what you call secure on-premise and private cloud installation. So it's not online translation. Most of the time it's on-premise, which is very important for our customer. We are offering 150 language pairs, but more important, we are offering domains. Most of the time it's not the standard language translation, it's domain translation. And we have a lot of tools that we call user and productive tool to connect and to make the translation inside the enterprise infrastructure, to connect with the user, to have plugin on your desktop, and so on. And our market is mostly B2B and institution, large institution. So for us, the NMT Odyssey started, as Sacha was saying, 2 years ago in 2016. So it was a proof of concept for us. We tried sec-to-sec attention and some other framework, and we were convinced very quickly that it was the way to go. And in few months, we were able to outperform the system, online system, Google, namely, for Chinese English. That was a very competitive language and very hard to make improvement. And we saw that we were able to make that working, and we put all energy on that development. So we launched a commercial NMT solution in October 2016. So it was just 1 week after Google. So we missed the first launch. And we call that PNMT. But more important, with Harvard, we continue working on that. And we launched OpenNMT. So it was December 2016. And we have put a dedicated team. And we are putting a lot of passion in that support of OpenNMT. We have so far, we have trained 110 language pairs for 8 different domains, and we have made hundreds of customized systems for our customers. And NMT, as a matter of fact, has shifted all the focus of the company. For all the business has changed since we have opened NMT. So making a NMT model is something that is kind of simple and very fun. So I like to say that even implementing an NMT engine is a project that you can do in 1 weekend. Or it's a 1 week master implementation, master level implementation. And it's fun. You do that, and yeah, there is the different brick. You connect together, and then you can play with that. You have GPU. And basically, what you just need to do is you take some data, you train, and translate. And that's all. And it is a starting point. It is a fun point. The thing is that very quickly it starts not being very fun, because first there is some setup issue. So we using a GPU, so has a lot of implies a lot of IT work. So first you need to have the computer, then you need to install some libraries. Not all of them are compatible. There is some drivers. So the setup part is the first part that makes the process a bit less fun. And then quickly it becomes a bit more complicated. And if you want to do it right, you need to start having some attention on what you are doing. So you cannot just put any data. You need to put some pre-processing in that. And then after, of course, you need to evaluate a bit the result, because getting some translation is good, but how good is the translation? And it starts making the process a bit more complicated. And it continues like that. Then after, you realize that you need to clean up your data to make the data even cleaner. And then you, when you look at the evaluation, you wonder, but is it right or not? So here is the number of paper that has been published over the last 4 years on neural machine translation. And this gives you an idea. In 2017, there has been more than 200 papers that has been published in neural machine translation. And when you maintain some open source code, the main question you have is, do you have the right software? Do you have the right implementation? Do we have the right model, the state-of-the-art implementation? So for us, it was a lot of work just to try. And implementing 200 papers, it's something that we cannot do by ourselves. We need a community for that. And at the same time, there is kind of some friendly competition, which is the other NMT framework. There is basically around one new framework every month that is coming out, open source framework. So it's kind of a competition, because it's, as I mentioned, it's very easy to make a first implementation. And then the question is how this project will survive over the time. And Guillaume will give some insight on why OpenMT has been surviving over the first year of implementation. So it drives you to wonder to this cycle. So you are training, you are evaluating, you are comparing with other systems, and then you are improving, and you have this cycle, and there is a lot of energy to make that working, and to make that working well, and to make sure that that at the end you have the quality that is ready for production, because you don't just want to have one NMT output, you want to have the best NMT output. And what if there is something that you miss? What if the corpus is not clean enough? So all of this is becoming very, very tedious and a lot of additional works. There is also, on our side, we don't just want to train some basic system, we want to customize the system. So this makes an additional layer of complexity where we want to be able to adapt your system to a new domain very quickly, and you need to think about that. We need to think also about the deployment. So deployment is not just you want to have a translation, so you want to connect your translation, for instance, with your Trados plugin or with your system, in production system. You want to deploy that because NMT is relatively slow, so what if you want to make thousands of translations per second? So this is the new problematic that come out, and if you want to be ready for production, you cannot just ignore them. You need to take into account all of that. And the last point that is becoming very complicated is that when you are doing something like production with 100 language pairs, you need to monitor all of that. And there's a lot of work of monitoring. So you have GPUs on a lot of computers all around the world, and you need to launch your process, make sure that they're not failing, evaluating them, putting the result together. And this monitoring process, it's very, very hard, because a training will take maybe 1 week, 2 weeks, and you are launching process that will end in 2 weeks, and you need to check that everything is coming back together, you didn't miss anything, the data preparation. So all of this makes the actual going to production very complicated. So for Sistran, our motivation and commitment for an open source are the following. So we need to be, so if we want to use open source system and contribute to open source system, we need to be state of the art. We cannot have a quality that is not at the state of the art, but otherwise any other framework will work better, and all the focus we'll put will be lost. So that means that we need to have a real focus on evaluation, and Vincent will told us about evaluation, on reading papers, on implementing, on testing ideas, and for that we need to have all the research community around. And it's very important that this is being done in an open source project where we are mixing industry research. And If we want to share, we cannot just share the technology. We need also to share the rest. What I was mentioning, which is the tedious part, how you make the training possible for 100 language pair. So you can do that for one language pair, for 100 language pair, and for going to production, you need to take into account all of that. So Sisran, us, we have been really focused on sharing not only the technology, but the know-how. So there is a forum where we are sharing a lot of ideas, a lot of experiments we are doing. And the process. The process is very important for us because it's really the blocker at the end of the day. The open source project must have some short-term flexibility. So if something, we have any feedback from customer, we need to adapt very quickly. But at the same time, we need to provide them with long-term maintenance plans. So we are very glad that we have some big companies that are using OpenMT in production, and we cannot just tell them that in two, three months we won't support anymore the software they have been installing in their infrastructure. So we need to commit to a long-term maintenance. And for us, the most important in all of that is that we had to be ready for business use case. So, and it is what I mentioned, all the flow that and all the components. We don't want to keep something secret, because if we are keeping something secret, then we are kind of breaking the spirit of the open source sharing. So we cannot just say, okay, we are sharing that part, but we are hiding the secret component that nobody knows about, because first, a lot of people will know about it, has been implemented somewhere else, and we lose the benefit of the sharing, the global sharing. So just to show you the type of typical question, nightmare question that we get and that people get when they are starting on OpenNMT is what type of CUDA driver, what is the version of OpenNMT I should use, but I read that the Sokai implementation is better, so I will switch to Sokai. Do we implement such a such model because it's important? Where can I find the corpus? So all of that is the day-to-day, so it's not anymore the fun part. It's what you need to refocus on. So when we contributed to OpenNMT, so we worked on the core technology, but at the same time, we worked also on the layers around, and for us, it's very important. So we have one of the first thing, big contribution we made was to integrate some fully ready tokenization. So it's very simple tokenization. You just need to take a text and split in two parts, but you need to take care also of the de-tokenization, so that you don't need some additional software somewhere to do that. So we wanted to have everything ready in the framework. So we did what you call the tokenization. We implemented some REST API, some simple REST API. We added some hooks because some users, and we'll hear about that, Panos, for instance, is using part of speech tagging in his flow. So he has to do part of speech tagging on the fly in his process. So we added some hooks in the process to extend the framework. And we added something that is called a sampler. Sampler is when you have very large data set, 100 million sentence. You cannot train on 100 million sentence as one shot. You need to sample from this data, and we wanted that to be convenient and fully integrated. So today we are announcing what you call the NMT wizard. So it's a new layer, that's a new tool that that will be available, or maybe it's already available on GitHub. I don't know if it's open. So it's a new application part of OpenNMT, and it's one other layer to make the training and the implementation and deployment of NMT engine in general, so OpenNMT but NMT in general, more easy. And I will describe that part now. So we started by taking this kind of OpenNMT code that I mentioned, and the different layers that we have around. And we put that in a Docker with a different entry points. The entry points were to make training, but to also to make translation deployment. So we are not totally ready on deployment, but it will be coming soon. And basically, we have created some kind of unified Docker and entry point for different type of frameworks. So we started with OpenNMT Lua because it is our playground in some way, and then very quickly, we added the other framework that we have in OpenNMT, so OpenNMT Pi and OpenNMT TensorFlow. So they have all in the same Docker with the same entry point. So we have normalized completely the way to run that. So why it's interesting for you or for anyone who wants to implement system is that the Docker is including everything. You just need to have the Docker and you launch a training. Everything about setting up libraries, compiling the code, and whatever is in the Docker. So there is no installation, zero installation process in all of that. And then we continued, because if we do that for OpenMT, we can do that for other framework, because evaluating other framework is very important for us too, because we need to compare. We cannot just be an isolated framework. We need to be comparable with the other framework. And to be the best way to be comparable is to put the other framework inside the same Docker. So we have already integrated Nematoos with the training and the translation feature, and we even have integrated Google Translate, so in the same Docker. So of course we cannot train with Google Translate, but the same Docker Translate will, with exactly same API, you will be able to translate with Google, with Nematoos, or with the model you will have trained with OpenNMT, Lua, PyTorch, or TensorFlow. So this can be further extended, so we have not done that yet, but we will at some point. We need to integrate the other framework, MarionMT, SOCI, Tensor to Tensor, and whatever. So for us, it's very important, because if we do that, we can compare. We can compare in a fair way, and Vincent will tell us more about fairness in evaluation. So once you have done that, then we are the Docker file, we made a system to launch a Docker, so it's the minimum. So you have your Docker, so you just launch your Docker on some server. You just need to pass some configuration file, and you launch your task on your Docker, and then at the end, you have your model. So it's very basic. You launch your model, this first step, launching a service. And then if we could launch on one service, we wanted to launch on multiple. So if you have 10 servers on your data center, then you have the way with the same tool to control 10 servers directly. So you will run from your desktop, from your phone if you want. You can launch 10 trainings in all your server of your data center, or your GPU that are in your cellar, wherever. It's triggered by the same tool. So it is what you call the resource management. We can manage different resources, IT resources. And then we went a step further. Oh, there is something wrong with my animation, sorry. So we extended to different service. So if we can train a local GPU, we wanted to train the same way on cloud service. So we did some collaborative work with Amazon, and we made the connector with EC2. So with the same command line, we'll be able to run on EC2 on your server that is just next to you, your training. No setup, no IT, nothing to do. It will be launched. We have implemented also a Torque grid system connector. So if you are using Torque, it is supported. And we are working on OpenStack. OpenStack is one of the standard that is used, for instance, for OVH. In France, to control cloud service, computing cloud service. So there is far more. So we could extend to Google GPU cloud. We can extend to other services. So this will come progressively. But we want that to be simple. So in some way, when you will be using the NT wizards, you won't see a difference to launch the service task on EC2 on your server. And then the last part that was missing is that we added some queuing system. So it's nice to be able to launch a training, but we don't want to launch one training generally. We want to launch 20 trainings. And you want to take your weekend and see what happened on the Monday. So you don't want to be there and every 3 or 4 hours monitor your system. By the way, it is what you are doing when you are starting playing with NMT engine. Every 3 hours, you wake up and you look what is the status. So, but you are going to production, you don't want to do that, and you cannot ask people to do that. So we have implemented the queuing system. So you launch your task, and they will dequeue, and they will launch the depending on the different resource you have on Amazon or wherever. So in short, the NMT wizard is, if I want to summarize, is that we have one single command line. So this is typically what the command line to launch one training using OpenMT TensorFlow on EC2. So here I'm selecting some instance on EC2. And with this command line, I'm launching a training on this instance with my configuration file. And that's all. I have nothing more to do than that. The data will be obtained automatically from the service. Everything will be taken care of. You don't need to make any hard lifting to have all of this together. And then you can monitor your progress. So you have a command line here, very simple, that shows that you have different tasks running. One is completed, one is allocated, one is queued. And then you can list at what is happening, where are you training, and what if there is some issue anywhere. So You will find the documentation on OpenMT and MT Wizard. Tomorrow we have a session in the Hackathon Day for people registered for Hackathon, or training session, where you will be able to launch OpenNMT, OpenMT Pi, OpenMT TensorFlow, or even Nematoos training on EC2. So thanks to Amazon, who has been sponsoring this event. We have a lot of credit on EC2, and we'll be playing with them tomorrow. The view is that it will facilitate the training and the deployment of OpenMT models, of course, because it's our focus on OpenMT models, but also to benchmark the other systems. Once again, if we want to compare with SOC-I, with Nematoos, we want to be able to compare in a way that we can reproduce, and not just on one computer with one version of the data. We want to be able to say, okay, just train this system, and I want to compare and be able to redo it later with the same condition. So this is the NMT wizard. In perspective, there's more perspective. So we are not yet done. So we are not at the point yet where you are just click at somewhere and get your NMT model ready. But we think that we can continue. So our mission in OpenMT is to make that training cycle simpler and ready for production. So we are working internally on more bricks. For instance, this is one of the components we have been implementing on the top of the NMT wizard, where not only you have launched different models, so each of these circles is a model. Not only we can launch models, but we can also, with the nice user interface, compare them, see the evolution of the model over the time, so we can make a branch on this model. We will train two models to see with different parameters what is happening. We have tests, evaluation on all the models simultaneously, so we can go further, and we'll continue working to make that simpler. And at the end of the day, we think that for the industry, the focus on industry should be on the data preparation, on the parameters we want to use, and you don't want to focus on the IT. So with the NMT wizard, we are trying to take away the IT part, all the hard work that is involved there. Of course, you rely on the technology, and the technology is progressing thanks to the very active community we have OpenNMT, but this layer is as important as the technology. I think it's the thing connecting the end users with the researcher, which is the strength of OpenNMT. Thank you very much. Is there any question?
Okay, maybe this question is very related to the next talk about evaluation, but I was wondering, in terms of comparing different frameworks, is it actually very, really so crucial to, well, can we expect such huge differences between two frameworks, for example, between OpenNMT and SOC-I, and how do we measure it, and is it really so critical? Maybe there are other, well, questions that come very important, like the usability, how easy it is to get into the code, modify it, and that kind of things. Maybe it's even more important that actual minor differences in blue score that don't really matter to the user in the end.
No, so you are totally true. One common point, and this is exciting, one common point about all the open about the NMT framework today is that we have all the same technology. So there is no secret ingredient from anybody, because we have all implementing the same model. But, and Vincent will show that, the way to call these parameters is very critical, and this we cannot. It's not easy to be sure that we have the right implementation. Sasha was mentioning, for instance, that the OpenMT Pi transform version is a bit behind the state of the art, and we cannot stop there. We need to make sure that we are at the state of the art. And after, yes, it doesn't make a difference on which framework you are. What makes a difference for the end user is usability, modularity, and it is what also Guillaume will be talking about. But definitely, it is our main focus.